Oh God, in obedience to your holy words of wisdom, we honor our mothers today in grateful worship to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. So we rise to the singing of our first hymn, our opening hymn. We sing the mighty power of God. Nowhere does it better than Open Door Believers Chapel. Shall we keep standing for prayer as we call on one of our leaders in the congregation, Brother Fernando Williams, to lead us to the throne of grace. Brother Williams. Welcome to Open Door Believers Chapel. I always say this, for the sake of our visitors, you need to know what kind of church you're worshiping, right? We are a Plymouth Brethren Assembly. Plymouth Brethren started in a place called Dublin in Ireland, but they didn't call it Dublin Brethren, you know, that's all like dumpling, you know? But from Plymouth, England, it moved around the world as a great missionary movement. And we are a brethren assembly telling us that the men, the heads of the families, are the leaders of the church. Not one man. And visitors come and, you know, they call me pastor. I do a little pastoral work, but really, it's a plurality of leaders that run this assembly. Welcome. Today is a special day. You know, around the world, different ethnic bodies celebrate Mother's Day differently. I think the Hispanics did it on Thursday, or the 10th. Yeah, the 10th, right? Somebody just asked me, how are they doing Mother's Day thing on the radio? Tell them, I'm not a mother, I'm a bother. I was a bother to my mother, right? I mean, who was the rich boy wasn't that, huh? Then after, okay, he used to give his mother a lot of trouble, too. That's why I should love him. spend some more time correcting him. Welcome. Special day. Today we honor mothers. We don't worship mothers, yeah? Mother's Day actually was started in the Anglican Church, and until today they make it a big thing, and it's very important. In the old days, the children went a-mothering. Obviously, some older mothers encouraged them, and it was really from one Sunday school class. And they went to look for the mothers after church, sang for them and do little things for them. And so, and today, it's spread around the world. And so, as a church, we give God thanks for our mothers. Now, a special gift is provided for mothers. If you're a mother and you don't get one, let's put up your hand. Somebody will serve you gladly. Beautiful. This gift, every year, a certain family take that responsibility. From a long time, from it started. It was started by Sister Heidi Gutierrez. And, you know, her daughter-in-law, that means her son, married this young lady. Yeah. And, you know, they carried it on. And we give God thanks to Sister Jackie Gutierrez and Brother Ian. It wasn't Ian, we wouldn't have Jackie, you know. Ian's handsomeness attracted her, you know. And so over the years, they have taken up this responsibility to give a little token of love and remembrance to the mothers. And today's one, Roots. Roots. Roots really is a revival of old-time substances. You see, so here it is. It's time to grow deeper. This came out of the sessions at On Floor, a mother in Israel in this church. How do the ladies? You get me? And the ladies have decided to grow deeper in the Lord. And that's really affected this church. On Floor, you start the next session yet? She know what I mean. Some weren't able to go. She wanted six ladies, then she said she takes eight. And I said, she'll take 10, no more, and then she had 24. You get me? Good. And the ladies all reported a blessing. And so, every time you drink, remember this. I know some of you are going to put it up to remember Mother's Day. Don't make the rude children broke it up. Please, no more to give. And welcome. Some of you are visitors. Some of you are here for the first time. I know some of you left your church to come here. Thank God. And we'll have our real worship. And today, our service is centered, as you can see, on the wisdom of God. We've been doing a series here of teachings. We started at Proverbs, but really we're going through the entire Bible. And it concerns the foolish woman and the wise woman. Well, as women become mothers, so there's a foolish mother and there's a wise mother. Some of us were raised by foolish mothers. Not your fault. Some of us were privileged to be raised by wise mothers. My mother was wise. When I was a teenager, she tried to beat me once, and that proved how wise she was. I tensed up. She nearly broke her arm. I smiled. She got wise, and my father came and said, "The boy, I turn man." You know what I mean? Give my man lick. I never disobeyed my mother again. Now, my father didn't beat me. My father was a footballer, you know, and cricket, a sportsman. He was a center forward. That means he could buck the ball. I couldn't do it. A ball hit me one day in my head for 3 weeks. My father just called me and opened me up and go, "So, buck me." And I went down. That's a man lick. Yeah, I was, don't come show up in this house and disrespect my wife. I'm serious, you know. So, take care. God bless you. Today is a beautiful day. I'm looking forward to it. Wednesday we are here, 5:30. If you don't come, some of your members are you're slackening up. You need to come Wednesday night. I know you can't come every Wednesday, but try to be here this Wednesday. We're still doing the biblical teaching, the biblical history, the practice and the purpose of the head covering. But it is more than just the top of head covering. It's a whole teaching, a doctrine through the scriptures. And you need to read the New Testament now, and you need this one. You need this one. A lot of problems you have in your life, understanding Christianity. If you don't understand this, you understand the rest. And so 5:30 Wednesday to 7, and supper is provided for all who come. 4:30 Friday, Bible club, and the children have a ball of a time. And there are team that come, there are, you know, faithful people that teach the children. There are other clubs too. Maybe the children can go to Ann Gardens once. And Sister Sandra, and Sister Yvonne's club, and Tricelyn's club. There are different clubs. We work with the children. Next Lord's Day, a special day. Next week is supposed to be Pentecost, where the church celebrates the rebirth of the church. 10:45, community worship service. At this time, Brother Richard Williams will come to the platform. He'll be doing our scripture reading. Scripture reading is taken from the passage of scripture that impacted the ladies. Proverbs 31. We're reading from verse 10 to the end. After which, our worship team, Brother Richard, came in and will minister to us in song.
An excellent wife, who can find? She is far more precious than jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not harm all the days of her life. She seeks wool and flax and works with willing hands. She is like the ships of the merchant. She brings her food from afar. She rises while it is yet night and provides food for her household and portions for her maidens. She considers a field and buys it. With the fruit of her hands, she plants a vineyard. She dresses herself with strength and makes her arms strong. She perceives that her merchandise is profitable. Her lamp does not go out at night. She puts her hands to the distaff and her hands hold to the spindle. She opens her hand to the poor and reaches out her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of snow for her household, for all her household are clothed in scarlet. She makes bed coverings for herself. Her clothing is fine linen and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sits among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them. She delivers sashes to the merchant. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she laughs at the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her the fruit of the land of her hands, and let her works praise her in the gates. This is the word of the Lord.
Shall we rise for worship? Now, our first song, the In a Very Own Language. You don't have to, if you have the baby sitting, you don't have to get up, you know, darling. You sit down and hold your baby, man. Sit down and hold your baby. This is a church where we're free in the spirit. Don't fear, you must rise. I must say something about this song first, though. It was written by a mother right here from out of the Creole Bible. Okay? So if we want to sing it today in the spirit of the mother who wrote it, and she had a lot of energy. You get me? So let's go. The people will obey the Lord.
Thank you.
I make them sweat. Shall we turn our song sheets to the other side, please? Very short declaration this morning, taken from Proverbs. Now, the declaration, I'd like to tell this for the sake of our visitors, is the most important part of our worship service. Some people think they're singing. No. What happened to those who can't sing then? Right? All right. It is offering back God's word. We honor and we acknowledge that God's word is the thing for our lives. And so in worship, we take it and we say, Lord, this is your word that has blessed us, that you have given to guide us. Take it back in worship. So together, let's read. Blessed are those who find wisdom, those who gain understanding, for she is more profitable than silver and yields better returns than gold. She is more precious than rubies. Nothing you desire can compare with her. Long life is in her right hand. In her left hand are riches and honor. Her ways are pleasant ways, and all her paths are peace. She is a tree of life to those who take hold of her. Those who hold her fast will be blessed. This is the word of the Lord. You know that you have read that? There's a verse in the scripture that says, if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God. You know, and it is something that we need to do. I'll give you a few seconds to pray as the Holy Spirit reveals to you the particular area in our lives that we need to pray about. Today, in our Mother's Day service, we'll have two reflections on motherhood. As I said earlier, we've been looking at the scriptures, wise mothers, foolish mothers. And a little committee came up with the idea that we should try and get two mothers to share about their mothers, how they were brought up. And so it takes a little honesty, a little right timing before the Lord, and dignity, Christian dignity, you know, to come here and to share this kind of reflection. And today's first reflection comes to us from Sister Kimberly Allen, a member of our worship team and choir. And she'll be sharing with us her experience of growing up with her mother. You're not under the judgment of God. Everybody's waiting. Yeah, I'll just tell people. Don't be nervous. If you're nervous, they're more nervous. If you got it.
Titus chapter 2, verses 3 to 5. Older women then should be reverent in the way they live, not to be slanderers or addicted to too much wine, but to teach the younger women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled, pure, and to be subjects to their husband, so that no one will be maligned to the word of God. Reading these verses to you all points a clear picture of a virtuous woman and how it should be passed down to the younger women leading Christ-centered lives. My story is very different. On Wednesday nights, Daddy has been teaching us the importance of the head covering. And his teaching started with describing the different types of mothers in Proverbs. You have the foolish, sinful, strange woman, and then the wise woman. It breaks my heart to stand here and tell you that Looking back on my life, my hero, my mother, was a foolish woman, as depicted in the book of Proverbs. Let me tell you a little about what and where she came from. She is one in a family of 16 with 10 girls and 6 boys. In my mom's house growing up, the Lord was not an invited guest. My grandmother, practicing what she knew and raising so many children, chose to condemn her children by speaking evil over them and teaching each of the girls the practice of witchcraft. They were also denied an education. In Proverbs 9, verse 14, you see the foolish woman simply repeating what wisdom was saying in verse 4 and 6. She is simply imitating. My grandmother was imitating what she knew, and my mother continued to imitate what she knew. It was a generational pattern. Each generation in my family were imitating the other, like the foolish woman. My mother, coming from such a broken place, started life early when she gave birth to me at an early age of 18. She was alone, as my father had no knowledge I existed. And even when he learned of me, he chose to stay away. My mom tried to provide a life for me by working at the local witchcraft supply store and performing small jobs of the craft to make money. However, even though my mom was imitating what she saw, she refused to teach any part of the craft to me. So even in the midst of evil, there was a glimmer of hope. God was breaking a chain in my life way before I was even his. However, failing to escape the bondage placed on her by her mother, all she faced was depression, pain, and sorrow. Many days, my frail body paid the cost for the hard time she was going through. The kicks, the punches, the bruise, and the open wounds were terrible, but she refused to give me up to my grandmother, as she knew what was about to happen. When I was 7, my mom brought home a man and introduced us. Wisdom gives life, and the foolish woman offers death. Just 1 month after being introduced to this man, while my mom was at work and I was at home alone, but my grandmother was in her home, which was in the same yard, I went home to take a bath, and after bathing, this man entered the house with a key my mom had given him. He showed me a sock filled with money and asked if I wanted it. I said yes. He then lifted his hand as to touch me, but something happened. I know now that the Lord stood up for me. I boldly told him no, and that my grandmother would soon come looking for me. He looked at me with surprise and told me not to tell anybody, and he promised that money in that sock to me. I went and told my grandmother what happened, and she waited for my mom to get home. As my mom got home, she and grandma started to argue, and my grandmother ordered us off her land. With nowhere to go, my mom quit her job and moved us in with the same man who made numerous attempts at me over the next 6 years she was with him. Proverbs 5 and 6 says, she does not ponder the path of her life. Her ways are unstable. She does not know it. My mom decided to end the relationship after all the heartaches, the fight, and infidelities. She moved on quickly, found herself in another relationship. Only this time I was older, and the problems we faced were about to be repeated, and it was going to be way harder. I remember coming home from school, and my mom would always send me to go look for this man. Though unwilling and uncomfortable, I had to go. or my mom would threaten to send me to school with no lunch. Little did both of us know, while I was going to look for this man, he started to develop something towards me. He started to become obsessed with me. He would bore holes in the bedroom walls so he could peek at me whenever he can. He even would go under the house so he could look up in the cracks of the floor. His obsession caused a rupture in the already weak relationship I had with my mom because she thought that it must be me doing something to cause this obsession. By the time I was in second form, he was beginning to attempt to touch me. At this time, I was battling depression and a deteriorating self-esteem. But I also had a strong determination to graduate high school and break the trend of dropping out of school. But there was no one guiding me, no one cheering me on as I passed from class to class. Like my mom, I did not know about God. I did not know about the God who cares and who loves me no matter what. I always thought, how could anyone love me after going and enduring so much? One morning in third form, I thought to myself, I should end all this and leave this cruel world. After all, the one person I had, my mom, was rejecting me. I purchased several types of medication from a store with money I was saving. I took every one of that medication that I bought on my way to school. All I remember was waking up in the hospital and my mom beside me. It took 2 days to pump out the poison from my system. I had to go back home with my mom and continue to live with this man because my mom thought that she needed him to survive. I had to see a psychologist twice a week, but they couldn't help me. I needed something greater in my life, so I started to visit Open Door every once in a while. I was invited by a friend and a teacher. I only came when I needed comfort, but I never stayed. I was about to graduate high school when this man made his last attempt at me in a big way. I reported him to the police, and the case went in front of the judge. To my surprise, the judge was my neighbor and was aware of my situation and the problems I had with this man. He was sentenced to 3 years in prison for attempting to molest a minor. Ephesians 4 and verse 18 says, they are darkened in the way, in their understanding, and alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to their hardness of heart. I moved out of my mom's house to gain independence. I rekindled the relationship with my mom, who felt guilt for all that had happened to me. I worked different jobs trying to find my niche in life. I had a few boyfriends as I tried earnestly looking for love. I was determined to get married and live a good life. I did not want to imitate what my mom did, but my heart was filled with pain, rejection, and anger. I needed it to fix it. I met my now ex-husband on my 21st birthday. After living together for a year, I got pregnant with my daughter. Although we were experiencing hardship and problems, I was so determined to get married that I asked him to marry me, and we got married. I placed myself in a mental jail where I was not good for anything, and whatever I did was never good enough. I hardly ate. I couldn't wait until Thursday so that I could go to the casino or to a friend's house where we played cards straight through till morning and repeated the next weekend. It took my mind off my marriage, but I had no one to teach me about marriage, no one I can turn to with my issues. My marriage did not last. I was becoming a foolish, sinful woman. I was crushed with disgust for myself. I dropped to my knees and cried out to a God I know nothing about to save me. Please save me. The Lord started a work in me that moment. Ever since, He has been showing me things in my life that is stopping me from being closer to Him. I know now that I am his daughter. He confirms my existence long before I cried out to him. I was lost, but now I am found. My little family is gone. My daughter is with my ex-husband, but I do not feel alone. I am liberated by the love the Lord and Savior who taught me to love myself and accept nothing less than the true love I know now. My mom may have been a foolish woman, as described in the book of Proverbs, but she kept me from the life of witchcraft, and I graduated high school. So that generational cycle stopped with me. On Wednesdays, Daddy taught us four characteristics of the foolish woman. One, they are lacking in God's wisdom. They are immature in the word of God. My mom is like that. But seeing my transformation in the Lord, she has started to follow and listen to the word of God, and now even asking questions. Two, foolish people resist the glory of God's wisdom. Being involved in witchcraft, my mom would laugh at God's words and mock sin, but now she is realizing the word of God is life and only sin, and sin only leads to death. Foolish women disregard or despise the glory of God's wisdom. Fools hate knowledge. They have no fear of God and believe only in themselves. My mom would have never come to church before, but recently now, she comes, and I am praying that the Lord breaks down her barriers one at a time because she seems willing to learn about him. The fool has the sin of disbelief. My mom's mind was once closed to the transforming power of God, but I know now she believes there is a God. And I am praying that her heart of stone will be changed into a heart of flesh as she continues to listen to the word and come to church and open herself up to the Holy Spirit. I know she will be transformed as I am transformed. My mom and I are closer more than ever. We have a bond and a love that will not be broken. There are still hardships and setbacks, but with God's grace, I am far more equipped to face them, knowing Jesus is always present and working on me. I will always be grateful that the Lord changed my life, because in changing my life, he started to change my mom's. Thank you for listening to my story.
Shattered, you see home. I see broken, but all you see is beautiful, and you're helping me to believe. Restoring me piece by piece. There's nothing too dirty that you can't make worthy. You wash me in mercy. I am clean. There's nothing too make worthy. You wash me in my chest. Oh, I'm coming alive to joy and destiny. 'Cause you're restoring me piece by piece. There's nothing too dirty that you can't make worthy. You wash me in mercy. I am clean. There's nothing too dirty, Lord, that you can't make worthy, Jesus. You wash me. Washed in the blood of your sacrifice, your blood flowed red and made me white. My dirty rags are purified. I am clean. Washed in the blood of your sacrifice, your blood flowed red and made me white. My dirty rags purified. I am clean, I'm clean. Oh, washed in the blood of your sacrifice, your blood flowed red and made me white. My dirty rags are purified. I am clean, I am clean.
Show me your face, fill up this space. My world needs you right now. My world needs you right now. I can't escape being afraid. Fill me with you. My world needs you right now.
Show me your face, fill up the space. My world needs you right now. My world needs you right now. I can't escape.
Bring with it a sound that points us to you right now. Erase substitutes right now. Fix what I see. And God, please fix me. My world needs you right now. Let us see you.
Why I'm not ashamed to
me your face. Come fill this space. My world needs you right now. My world needs you.
Last testimony, our second testimony on motherhood is from Mrs. Candice Smith.
Okay, as most of us who are mothers in here know, motherhood is definitely not an easy job. And believe you me, half the time you think you are doing a horrible job. Every now and again, when my sisters get together, we tell each other, man, like, mommy never used to reel up with kids or us so much. We didn't reel up with three kids enough. We need to stop, we need to lay off, we need to be patient like mommy. And then the next minute, I reel up again. So we admit our shortcomings, and it's really hard. But as hard as motherhood is, and the battle with self-doubt, I realize that at least I've had a good role model, who had provided me with a yardstick to measure my choices and actions against. When I was asked to reflect on motherhood from the angle of the four types of women found in Proverbs, without a doubt, I knew my mother fell in the category of the sensible woman. For those who have not been here on Wednesday nights, we are given the characteristics of each type of woman. And using this as my rubrics, my mother fulfilled the characteristics of a sensible woman. I'll just quickly summarize the characteristics. A sensible woman, first, displays prudent godliness that brings blessed wisdom to the home. Prudent here meaning wise, well-judged, sensible, and godliness meaning an active obedience that springs from a reverent awe of God. A sensible woman crowns her husband. She gives him the respect of his role, no matter what. Thirdly, a sensible woman is clothed in present hiddenness. Okay, if you all remember, on Wednesday night, we're doing the historical context. So this point was with a Hebrew woman using the head covering to show she was a virtuous woman, and that gave her communal respect. However, when I was thinking about my mother with her present hiddenness, I was thinking more along the verse in Proverbs and as well in 1 Peter that says she's clothed with strength and dignity and possesses a gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious in God's sight. And lastly, characteristic of a sensible woman, she teaches her children God's wisdom. So my reflection this morning will not be about all the characteristics. I centered only on the first one, and I asked myself this question: how has my mother's prudent godliness influenced my life and shaped my approach to motherhood? So how has my mother's prudent godliness influenced my life and shaped my approach to motherhood? Okay, first one, I stick in some verses, right? just random verses, just boom. So children are a gift from the Lord. Just like that, done. All right. So in answering the first question here, my mother's prudent godliness has given me a biblical worldview of motherhood. I view motherhood as a stewardship of the gifts that the Lord has entrusted me, my three sons. My children are not my own. They have been dedicated and given back to God. And I therefore have this awesome privilege and responsibility to raise them to love and serve the one who they rightly belong to. And it ain't me. And this is off. Sometimes I go off. I remember my co-worker the other day had to punish her child, and she was fretting that her child won't love her. I said, girlfriend, stop fretting. One, the child like three. You beat them, they crawl into your lap and they cry, they hug you up. Beat them when they're 13, then they start whole kind of malice. But at three, tough child. And I told her, who cares if they don't love you? It's yours, you still have a feeding, clothing, big deal. All right, moving on. So I dedicated my children to the Lord. I have this little song that I always sing for my children. Every now and again, I still sing for them, and they kind of get embarrassed now because I get too big. It's a very off-note song because I don't have the gift of singing. Thank you, Miss Vanjie. As well as making up songs. So I have this little note. I always sing, when I held you in my arms for the very first time, I looked up to heaven and I said, Dear Lord, this is, and I call the child's name, I give him back to you because he is yours. So that means that I will discipline them according to God's word. When they were younger and I spanked them, I told them if I didn't discipline them, then I would be disobeying God, and I will not do that. The foolish or ungodly mother easily allows a child to become the center of their world, but not so the godly woman. Obeying God's word in reverent awe is her goal. And therefore, a sensitive mother like my mother was balances a reverent obedience with the love of their child. Growing up, we knew our mother loved us, and she supported us in all things, but we were not her center of her life. And believe you me, we knew that. Did it hurt us? No, by no means. It gave me the right perspective when I had children of my own, and I realized that obedience and love for God came first, even above my children. The second point in my question that I'm asking, that how has my mother's prudent godliness influenced my life and shaped my motherhood, approach to motherhood? My random verse. Do not forsake your mother's teaching. They are a graceful wreath to your head. Okay. Having a sensible woman as a mother gave me confidence to approach her with my life issues, and I gave her the respect that her wisdom deserved by heeding her advice. My mother would be the one I went to first with any problems or questions as it pertained to my life situation. It wasn't that I didn't respect the wisdom of my lovely father, by no means. It's just I realized within her a quiet discernment and a sensible way that brought comfort that she would listen to my situation without judgment and weigh in either with a practical advice or a spiritual advice. And in the same way she gave advice, she sometimes scolded. If anyone in this church was at the end of her rebuke, can attest, she was firm with her scolding or rebuke, but gentle. You just had to hang your head and own up to whatever you were doing. And at the end, sometimes you said, I hear people say, thanks, Miss Lodi, or thank you, Mommy. Like, who the heck thank people for the point and tell you about yourself? But you thank Mommy, because the way she did it was like, just own it, man, just own it. So I remember once when I was a new mother, Jediah, he was young. I know you get caught up in that new motherhood. So everything about germs, not touch your hand, wipes. So I think Nicole had a cough one time and she was holding Jediah. And I tell her something, she was sneezing over the baby. And I tell her, Nicole, give me that baby, because you know I'm up all night with her when he gets sick. Well, after Nicole gone to her house and everything, Mommy called me in her room. You see, Mommy, she never scolded you in front of people. She called you to the side by yourself. And she told me, no, that's not the way to behave or treat your child. Because remember, my child is not my own, right? It's not my own. So stop going like it is your own. It was a family that raised a child and not one person. I never lose track of that. So after that scolding, which was really a gentle rebuke, I was left crying and asking God for forgiveness. Her scolding, in her blessed wisdom, always led to quiet introspection, which led to repentance. Next random verse. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. This is random, but applies to my mother because I believe it. My mother's prudent godliness was shown in the way she prayed for us, and we knew she was praying for us, whether for a subject I told her about that was giving me trouble or an illness I had when I was young. And that's the thing is, when you talk about mother or father, it's both mommy and daddy, but talking about mommy. Prayer formed a part of her life, and many times I found her lying in bed praying aloud in a very offbeat way. She wasn't, you won't find her on her knees. She probably couldn't have gotten up. So my mother was just on bed, and a lot of times I go in her room and she's just talking. I was like, Mommy, what are you talking? Just praying, calling out her names, calling out people's names from the church. She's just praying. And she did the same offbeat thing with singing songs, randomly singing songs. But anyway, she had her own offbeat way. I sincerely believe, still believe it with Daddy, I believe she and my father's prayers reached heaven way before mine. My one get kind of caught up in traffic. So when she prayed for our issue for me, I was comforted. And the thing is, I recall when she was sick, right before she died, she asked me how Kirk and I were doing. And she told me that she was always praying for me and my marriage. Just thinking about that blew my mind. Here she was sick, and she was still thinking about her children and bringing her problems before the Lord. When you have spiritual stalwarts like my mother in your life, like both my parents, then believing that Jesus is constantly interceding for us, or Jesus thinking about us and praying for us before facing Calvary, is easily understood. And this song we sang this morning, like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall and thought of me above all. When you have Christian parents, that relationship with your parents is easily transferred to a relationship with God. And you believe his promises, you believe his word, your faith is enriched by just observing the life of your parent, and in case, the godliness of my mother. So my sensible mother, in her godly prudence, has shaped my own prayer life. I pray about everything. I guess I'm a closet prayer warrior. And I teach my children to pray about everything. I tell them that God wants us to depend on him, and praying about everything fosters this dependence. What does it profit a man, last point now, to gain the whole world but still lose his own soul? Sometimes, as parents, we walk a tightrope between worldly ambition and Christ ambition. And unfortunately, I find myself having to give myself a shake, a mental shake, and asking the Lord for guidance when my perspective gets clouded and I tend to want to step into more worldly ambition. I watch many parents, Christian parents, with a heavy heart sometimes, driving home the wrong ambitions in their children. All they think is fine. And yes, it will produce productive citizens. And God knows, Belize really need more productive citizens. But my mother taught me in her prudent godliness that a job of a godly mother is not in raising productive citizens. That job is just halfway done. The real job is raising heaven-bound citizens. Because that is our role as stewards of the souls entrusted to us. It's not bodies entrusted to us, it's very souls that God has given us. So worldly ambitions such as pursuit of the highest education, the money, the big-time job, the big house, the two cars, that's not reality. And that's not the reality for a godly person or a godly mother. The reality is and will always be Christ. Don't get me wrong, because some of you know, the kids might go home this afternoon and say, no, I think I'll stop till 6 because the reality is Christ. Don't misconstrue. I'm not saying that education and good career is bad and something you should not work hard towards. No, you should work hard. And education is very important, especially these days where the job market is so competitive. Frankly, a rule, even a loose rule, but a rule nonetheless, in our house, was that we should all have our first degrees by the time we moved out. So, but back to the case where the lesson that my mother taught me was what my mother drove home in her prudent godliness was, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then everything else will fall into place. God and his work came first. So we had a Saturday class, but we were doing something for the Lord at church or just with the family. No, you know they go, but mommy, teacher, won't be me. No, you're not going. VBS camp, nothing could compete with those weeks. Don't even bring it nor take it, nothing. You're backside to go. I have big exams coming up. Could I stay home for this month, you know what I mean? Just study, contemplate this, and really season it down and ace it. I don't even bother bringing that up because I don't get shut down. Now, as a mother, I share that same mindset. And only as a mother now, I realize what my mother was doing, what my parents were doing. And I hope to instill that in my children. I tell my children I have lived and experienced the power of this verse. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything else will be added unto you. And my prayer is that my children learn it and apply it to their own lives in the future. So I am truly thankful that I have had a mother who was a sensible, godly woman who bestowed her blessed wisdom on her home, where from an early age she set my feet on the path of righteousness and said, "This is the way, walk ye in it." Amen.